Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to CEC Reset Live Lecture. Dear friends, as you all know that we are carrying and conducting series of lectures on database management. This is the fourth lecture on this very topic. Yesterday, we discussed about the models, the various models used in designing databases. Today we are going to discuss about how databases are designed, as well as we are going to discuss about the role of database administrator, designer and system analyst. And for this we have again with us in our studios Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey. He is associate professor in School of Open Learning, Department of Computer Sciences, as well as he is former director at Vivekanand Institute of Professional Studies. So first of all, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Uma Shankar Pandey, under whose able guidance today we are again going to get a deep insight into this very topic, along with the excellent examples which place he in between the lecture, so that this lecture seems to be very, very interesting as well as very, very easy to grab. So, Dr. Pandey, welcome once again to the CEC EDUSET Live Lecture.
Thank you. Let's start. Here, database architecture. See, MCA Spark's three label database architecture, metadata, why it is important, ISO information resource system. What is this ISO and IRDS? Now you can see here that MCA Spark's three label database architecture, Spark concerns database system, database, DDL, that is data definition language, database system, schema and data. A database is divided into schema and data. The schema describe the intention types. The data describe the extension data. Why? Effective, efficient. And see Spark 3 level database architecture separating concerns, schema, data, schema, internal schema, data, internal schema, data and external schema, as well as the conceptual schema. Now, you see Spark 3 level database architecture. Here you can see that the external schema 2, external schema 3, conceptualize this conceptual schema, internal schema and database. External schema is use of data, conceptual schema meaning of data, and internal schema storage of data. Now what is this conceptual schema? Describes all conceptually relevant, general, time invariant structural aspects of the universe of discourse, excludes aspects of data representation and physical organization and access. Like here you can see an example, customer, name, address, sex and age. An object-oriented conceptual schema would also describe all processes aspects. External schema describe parts of the information in the conceptual schema in a form convenient to particular user group's view, is derived from the conceptual schema. You can see an example, male teen customer, name, address, and here the teen customers, customer where X, the customer's name, address, sex and age is going to be related. Internal schema describes how the information described in the conceptual schema is physically represented to provide the overall best performance. You can see by example, a customer details are given, you can take it as an internal schema, and you see the BT on age and the index on the name. These things can be done. Physical data independence. External schema 3. The physical data independence is a measure of how much the internal schema can change without affecting the application program. Logical data independence. The logical data independence is a measure of how much the conceptual schema can change without affecting the application program. And now the schema compiler. You can see an example of the metadata, compiler and schemata. The schema compiler compiles schemata and store them in the metadata base. Here you can see the catalog, data dictionary and metadata base. Query transfer. You can see an example of metadata, data and query transfer, DML, that is data manipulation language, uses metadata to transform a query at the external schema level to query at a storage level. You can see in the ANSI Spark DBMS framework. Here you can see that the enterprise administrators, and then here the conceptual schema processor, application system administrator, database administrator, internal schema processor, metadata, external schema processor, and in downwards you can see the storage internal transfer, internal conceptual transformer and conceptual external transformers and the users. What is this metadata? What is it? System metadata, where data come from, how data were changed, how data are stored, how data are mapped, who owns data, who can access data, data usage history, data usage statistics. And what is this business metadata? What data are available? Where data are located, what the data mean, how to access the data, predefined reports, predefined queries, and how current the data are. Metadata, why it is important? System metadata are critical in a DBMS, whereas business metadata are critical in a data warehouse. ISO, IRDS, why? Are metadata different from data? Are metadata and data stored separately? Are metadata and data described by different models? Is there a schema for metadata, a meta schema? Are metadata and data changed through different interfaces? Can a schema be changed online? Or how does a schema change affect data? Now you can see here the ISO IRDS architecture. Meta schema, data dictionary schema, data dictionary data, and data. Meta schema describes all schema that can be defined in the data model. Data dictionary schema contains copy of meta schema, schema for the format, definitions, schema for data about application data. Data dictionary data, schema for application data, data about application data, and data raw formatted application data. Now again, ISO IRDS example, you can see here that the relations, real name, all name and don't, access rights, user relation and operations, relations have been defined, and then you can see the supplier and all. So these have a good example of this ISO IRDS. Database management system architecture. Take daily processing databases, file sharing databases, client server databases, basic client server databases caching, distributed databases, federated database, multi database, and parallel database. Now, what is this teleprocessing database? In the case of teleprocessing database, you can see here we have a different dump terminals which is connected with your communications line, mainframe, compute things, and the databases. Different application programs are there, DBM is there, and operating systems is going to be there. It is connected to your main database. Now, teleprocessing database's characteristic. Dump terminals are basically used. Application programs, DBMS and DB reside on the central computer. Communications lines are typically phone lines. Screen formatting transmitted by a communication line. User interface, character oriented and primitive. Dump terminals are gradually being replaced by macros. Teleprocessing databases are maximum in use nowadays. We are having, you can talk on telephone and you can discuss with anybody, anything like that. We are just getting an information about a particular item. We can use this kind of different databases. Now, file sharing database. You can see this is another kind of the database architecture is going to be there. Application programs, DBMS, and OS going to be there. Macros, LAN, file server, macro, and database is going to be there. The file sharing database characteristics, APs and DBMS on client macros, file server on server micro, client and file server communicate via LAN. Substantial traffic on LAN become large files and indices must be sent to DBMS on client for processing. Substantial stock contention for extended period of the time for the same reason. Good for extensive query processing on downloaded snapshot data. Bad for high volume transaction processing. Now, client server database, basic. Here you can see macros, LAN, macros are the mainframe, and DBs, databases. Client server database, basic characteristics. APs on the client macros. Database server on micro or mainframe. Multiple server possible. No data replica. Clients and database server communicate via LAN. Considerably less traffic on LAN than with the file server. Considerably less lock contention than with the file server. Client server database caching. You can see here the application program part 2 and different databases are going to be there. It's connected with the LAN, macros and the mainframe and database. The characteristics of the client server database is caching. DBMS on server and clients. Database server is primarily update site. Downloaded queries are cached by on the client. Cached queries are updated incrementally. Less traffic on LAN than with the basic client server database because only initial query result is downloaded followed by change logs. Less log contention than with the basic client server database for same reason. Distributed database, which is maximum in use nowadays, you can see the architectural figures here, application programs and DBMS, then OS is net and DB, external, internal, conceptually and internal, then different databases are going to be there. So macros are the mainframes and network is there. Distributed data characteristics, APs and DBMS are the multiple macros on the mainframe. One distributed database, communication via LAN or WAN, horizontal and or vertical data fragmentation, replicated or non-replicated fragmented allocation, fragmentation and replica transparencies, data replication improves query processing, data replication increases log contention and slow down update transactions. Distributed databases alternatives. Here you can see that partitioned, non-replicated, non-persistent replicated and partitioned replicated are going to be there. Federated database, this is another kind of database. Here application programs and DBMS are in the, almost in the distributed way here, but the network is in the federation schema. Here you can see is export schema 2, export schema 3, then conceptual and the internal and connected with your database. The characteristics of the federated databases. Each federated has a set of application programs, a DBMS and a DB. Part of the federated database is exported such that accessible to the federation. The union of the exported database constitute the federal databases. Federated will respond to queries and update requests from other federates. Federators have more autonomy than with a traditional distributed database. Multi-database architecture, you can see it here, application programs, multi-DBMS is going to be there and is connected with the network, example www, that world wide web. Conceptual, internal and databases are linked. The characteristics of the multi-databases is, a multi-database is a distributed database without a shared schema. A multi-DBMS provide a language for accessing multiple database from its APs. A multi-DBMS accesses other databases via a network like the www. Participants in a multi-database may respond to query and update requests from other participants. Participants in a multi-database have the highest possibility level of autonomy. Now another is parallel databases, a database in which a single query may be executed by multiple processes working together in parallel. There are three types of the systems: shared memory, shared disk, shared nothing. Parallel databases, shared memory. Processor share memory via bus. Extremely efficient processor communication by memory writes, bus becomes the bottleneck, not scalable beyond 32 or 64 processors. Here you can see that the processor, memory and disk, how these are going to be characterized. Parallel database, share disk. Processor share disk via internal network. Memory bus not a bottleneck. Fault tolerant with respect to processor or memory failure. It scales better than shared memory. Interconnection network to disk subsystem is a bottleneck used in Oracle RDB. Parallel databases shared nothing. You can see it here. It scales better than the shared memory and shared disk. Main drawbacks, higher processor communication cost, higher cost of non-local disk access used in Teradata database machine. Another very important rate, redundant array of inexpensive disk. Disk stripping improves performance via parallelism. Assume 4 disk worth of data is stored. Disk mirroring improves reliability via redundancy. Assume 4 disk worth of data is stored. Mirroring by copy of data bit parity. Database capabilities, data storage, queries, optimization, indexing, concurrency control, recovery, security. Data storage, disk management, file management, buffer management, garbage collection, compression. Queries, SQL queries are composed from the following. One is selection, point, range, conjunction, deconjunction, join, natural join, equal join, theta join, outer join, projection, set operation, Cartesian product, union, intersection, set difference, others, duplicate elimination, sorting, built-in function count, sum and recursives, not in SQL. SQL optimization, you can say here the select from that where and all kind of queries, it can be optimized through that. Query optimization, database statistics, query statistics, index information, algebraic manipulation, join strategies, nested loop, sort merge, index based, hash based. Indexing, why bother? Disk access time is 0.01 to 0.03 second. Memory access time is in microseconds, 0.00001 to 0.00003 seconds. Database are input output bound. Rate of improvement of memory access time divided by disk access time is very less than greater than 1. Things won't get better anytime soon. Indexing help reduce input output. Clustering versus non-clustering. Primary and secondary indices, input-output cost for lookup, heap, sorted file, you can see the single level index, multiple level index, BT, and hashing. Here view, caching incremental computation. Now concurrency control, you can see here by example this the flight incentives and reservations you can check, and this booking can be checked here easily. ACID transaction in the code. An ACID transaction is a sequence of database operation that the following properties: atomicity, either all operations are carries out or none is. This property is the responsibility of the concurrency control and the recovery subsystem. Consistency, a transaction map a correct database state to another correct database state. This requires that the transaction is correct, which is the responsibility of the application programmer. Now isolation, although multiple transactions execute concurrently such that interleaved, non-parallel, they appear to execute sequentially. This is the responsibility of the concurrency control subsystem. Another important thing is durability. The effect of a completed transaction is permanent. This is the responsibility of the recovery manager. Serializability is a good definition of correctness. A variety of concurrency control protocols exist. Two-phase, that is 2PL locking, deadlock and live lock possibility. Deadlock prevention, wait die, won't die it. Deadlock detection, roll back a transaction. Optimistic protocol, procedural optimistically backup and repair if needed. Pessimistic protocol, do not proceed it until knowing that no backup is needed. Recovery is another thing that are going to be there, that the possibilities are changed, reservation, the read and update, read, avail, and you can see here that you can get the things in that. Storage types, volatile, main memory, non-volatile, disk. Errors, logical errors, transaction fails, example, bad input, overflow. System error, transaction fails, example, deadlock. System crash, power failure, main memory lost, disk survivors. And disk failures, head crash, sabotage, fire, disk lost. What to do? Deferred updates, no undo or redo. Do not change database until ready to commit. Write ahead to lock to disk. Change the database. Immediate update, undo and no redo. Write ahead to log on disk. Update database anytime. Commit not allowed until database is completely updated. Immediate update. Write ahead to log on the disk. Update database anytime. Commit allowed before database is completely updated. Shadow paging. no undo, no redo. Ride ahead to log in disk. Keep shadow pace, update, copy only, swap at commit. Security, DAC, discretionary access control, is used to grant or revoke privileges to users, including access to files, record fields, read, write, update mode. MAC, that is mandatory access control, is used to enforce multi-level security by classifying data and users into security levels and allowing users access to data at their own or lower levels only. Peoples that work with the databases, system analyst, database designers, application developers, database administrators and end users. System analyst communicate with each prospective database user group in order to understand its information needs, processing needs, develop a specification of each user group's information and processing needs, develop a specification integrating the information and processing needs of the user groups, document the specification. What does database designers do? Choose appropriate structures to represent the information specified by the system analyst. Choose appropriate structure to store the information in a normalized manner in order to guarantee integrity and consistency of data. Choose appropriate structure to guarantee an efficient system. Document the database design. What application developers do? Implement the database design. Implement the application programs to meet the program specifications. Test and debug the database implementation and the application programs. Document the database implementation and the application programs. What do the database administration is doing? Manage the database structure. Participate in database and application development. Assist in requirement analysis. Participate in database design and creation. Develop procedures for integrity and quality of data. Facilitate changes to database structure. Seek community-wide solutions. Assess impact on all users. Provide configuration control. Be prepared for problems after changes are made. Maintain documentation. Manage data activity. establish database standards consistent with the data administrator standards. Establish and maintain data dictionary. Established data provenances. Work with data proponents to develop data access and modification rights. Develop, document, and train staff on backup and recovery procedures. Publish and maintain data activity standards documentation. Manage the database management system. Generate database application performance reports. Investigate user performance complaints. Assess needed for change in database structure or application design. Modify database structure. Evaluate and implement new DBMS features. Tune the database. Establish the database data dictionary, data names, formats, relationship, cross references between data and application program. End users. Parametric end users constantly query and update the database. They are keyed with transactions to support standard queries and updates. Casual end users occasionally access the database but may need different information each time. They use sophisticated query languages and browsers. Sophisticated end users have complex requirement and need different information each time. They are thoroughly familiar with the capabilities of the DBMS. Now see, what are the latest emerging database technologies? Web databases, which is widely used nowadays. Multimedia databases. Mobile databases. Data warehousing and mining, geographic information system that we call GIS, genome data management, temporal databases, and spatial databases. And thank you for the
Definitely, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much for delivering such a productive lecture. And as we try to give you excellent examples, and now we are going to conduct question answers round, not basically question answers round, because Dr. Pandey always have excellent examples, and through the examples, he try to teach his lessons. So, as we talked about the database management, what do you think, or what do you feel that this database management has given immense contribution in the field of the medical sciences?
You very rightly questions asked, Geeta. What is happening, as we are just discussing that emerging technologies, lot of things are happening, and still, as you very rightly asked question regarding the medical sciences, you know, we have just covered an area of genome theory. Now you understand, from genome theory we have a very large database about these genes and all. So what is having, putting all the informations in a proper manner using a database is a very difficult task. It's not that much, because the database size is very large. and you have to collect a large amount of data. For example, take example of a disease. When you are collecting the information of that, and that too from many years, you are collecting these things, and based on that you are making a diagnosis. What I mean to say is that having collection of data and to put those things manage in a proper way is not a very easy task, and how it you are going to make use of that particular data is also an important thing. So database is playing a very important role in medical sciences. Now even you go to the doctors, especially if you are belonging from any chronological kind of disease, heart, say disease of related to the heart, cardiac problem or like that. If you are visiting a doctor, even those doctors are creating their own databases about the parent, detailed information about the patients, each minute information which help them to take a proper decision regarding all test kind of reports and all. So in the medical sciences, databases is playing very important role, starting with an individual doctor, it could be individual patient, or even a big hospitals which are managing a large amount of data which facilitate them giving the proper benefit for analyzing a disease, for analyzing about the patients and all details. So in medical sciences, the databases is playing a very important role, because the longevity, as we have just discussed now, there are about the disk of RAID disk and so many things, concurrency, recovery, all these things, these features are also very important when you are going to maintain the use large databases, especially in the area of medical sciences.
Well said, sir. As you also quoted yourself, that many of the doctors have created their own databases, and with the help of that, they could predict the past history as well as they can relate to the present disease. Do you think so? If this could be incorporated within all the hospitals, and even the private doctors have this database management system, it would help the patient first of all not to keep the file of all the prescriptions or the past histories or the diseases from which he or she has been suffering.
Very rightly again asked the question, Hitika. What I am just trying to say, in the medical science, even some of the government departments, they are creating the medical details of each and every individual employee that is associated with their hospitals also. So although these are the very important information and very important information which can't be revealed to everyone, but these are linked with their hospitals. So every patient's detail, you don't call only patient, any general person's details are going to be with the hospitals. So these hospitals are very visualizing each and everything, and if the hospital feel that some kind of requirement, some kind of help need to be provided to those employees, those patients are who is not suffering or who is prone to those kind of diseases, these data is going to be very helpful. And under very rightly the next question which you ask, even government is also planning to provide insurance to all, each and everyone. In other words, insurance is going to be one safety point, but if you do have some details about the everybody's patients requirements, then the hospitals can make them very easily, they can help. So with having a detailed data of individuals or the different kind of disease and all, they can be collaborated together. It's a big task, but things can be done easily, and definitely it is going to be helpful to the society as well as the individuals also.
I think if at this end the Ministry of Health take a sincere step towards it, it would be very beneficial, because for example, if X falls ill in year 2000 and after that he falls ill in 2020 or in between, now if the person resides in Delhi and suppose he reside after 10 years he goes to some other state, if there is a database management in the sense that it could be accessed by any doctor, by any government hospital, do you think it would be more beneficial?
This feature is already existing, Geetika. You have very rightly pointed out, and you have given a very good example yourself, and this kind of features will definitely help you. Take example, if somebody is carrying some disease, he's traveling from some part of the world to India, if you are able to access, if you mean to hear the doctors, because these informations are very important only to the hospitals, to the doctors, not to be revealed sometimes to any individuals, or any other process, but definitely this kind of information will always help government to take a proper decisions. Now, just take example, you have rightly pointed out earlier what is happening. Nowadays, with the medical facilities, you can only just regarding cardiac diseases or different kind of diseases are taking place. Just by having the proper data, you are able to pronounce that this kind of disease are going to be there. Now you are missing about the Ebola. That is again based on that, are so many other diseases which are coming to you. Earlier it was not possible. You may listen that people die but don't know what are the reason. At the moment, at least sometimes you will be able to know this is because of the heart attack, because of the cancer, or because of some other reason. So what I mean to say that if you have the details, still a large amount of population in India, they don't have the access of so many things, or even the right information does not reach to the government also. Sometimes different kind of deaths are not taking place, births are taking place, but it's not reported to the government. So what I mean to say is, if the proper database is maintained, as you mentioned, Aadhaar is one of the thing just to create this kind of awareness to every individual. Every individual have identity, and maybe biological kind of information may be also attached at a later stage, which will help not only the government, all the doctors, hospitals, and every individuals can take a right path and right decision, especially for the health and other activities.
Definitely, sir. And as through your lecture, I could also predict out when we are talking about the medical sciences, if such databases are maintained, that is, when we are talking about a particular individual, if it's past history from right from the birth till his death, every data regarding the health and diseases are incorporated, it would be easier for the research people to conduct the further research.
You have very rightly pointed out, Gitika, I have just pointed out, because these the kind of diseases and the other kind of health related activity takes too much time to study. For example, what is the drug which is going to be used on a particular, you take a very simple example. Nowadays you are listening, mobile is very harmful for the body. Now what is happening, mobile has just come now 2, 3, 4 years back. It will take time to study, get properly that what is the impact of electronic devices on the body. Although early reports have shown something, but in the longevity, if you have a proper information and the information which is stored properly in a proper manner, what are the impacts to in the individual, to the society, and to hazard different kind. So these definitely help all these kind of information to research activity, and research people need all those data in a proper manner, not in the haphazard way. So they can help, especially in the area of diseases. Now every day you mention lot of diseases, for that they have the new technique to be developed based on the databases. Take an example of cancer, different kind of cancers, especially in the breast cancer, all the different kind of cancers, lot of computational studies have been made. Just by seeing the pattern, they can predict that this kind of disease is going to be happen. So definitely, if you have the proper information, proper data, by clustering and different methods, you can utilize those data to at least just tell that in the beginning that what kind of disease is going to be happen to whom, and this based on the symptom you can recover all those things. So what I mean to say is that definitely this data will help, especially in the medical research and taking a proper decision in this direction.
One more question, while we're discussing about this database management, and as we have talked a lot about the medical sciences, how database management could be very useful to the doctors and the organizations. So many a times we have seen that blood, which is an important concern for all the people, if somebody stuck into accident and one needs blood, if the hospital or the authorities have the database management that this many people have this blood group, they can be contacted very easily.
Very easily. Not only this, Kritika, you have very rightly, we have just discussed about the web databases, which is becoming now very important, and these kind of things are related, that immediate and information reach to the person person who is required. Maybe you have just seen two, 3 days back, some news was there that some accident has taken place at a place, and immediate some person, if he was not able to help an unknown person, he just make a photograph and send through the mobile to the concerned hospital, and immediately hospital people reaches there, and the person has been saved very much in time. So what I mean to say, it's very easy example although, but using this web databases, as you have just mentioned, the required person may get the blood from the proper place where he can get contact. Not only this, many other kind of help services can be provided if you are utilizing these proper databases. Another example I can just give you, because you have just mentioned, the use of database is very much important and things are very much in time. Now take example, when you are predicting about the weather. Now we just say that Mausam department is predicting this thing. Just imagine what the lot number of information they gather and they put it, they analyze it for years, and then they predict based on that. We use a big computer, supercomputers are involved in processing the those data, because that is a very huge amount of information we are getting. In the launching of a satellite, just imagine, we understand the satellite is launched. They have the big database stored with them. They are getting every day large amount of data. Now, important thing is how they are storing those data, how they are managing, and how they are making those data useful to them. So putting all those things together and analyzing, and as I mentioned, requirement of a big computers, big in the sense, big processor kind of computers. We have just discussed some of them in this lecture also, different kind of databases are going to be used for that purpose. So definitely database is playing a very important tool in every part of life.
Again, as we have discussed a lot about the medical sciences only, we discussed about the blood banks also. Sir, as India is suffering from not a disease, but we could say that organ donation is a very important concern in our country. So if we could be able to organize, and we would be able to know in advance who people are interested in donating their organs, this database could also be helpful there.
Definitely, as you mentioned, we are concerning in the medical science. Definitely, this will play a very important a database can be created who wants to donate their organs, and a database can be created for those who are requiring all those. So this will definitely play a very important role, and you can do it like that.
Definitely. And please have a glass of water, as Dr. Pandey is explaining throughout this lecture with the help of the examples. And I hope that you must be liking this lecture very much, because this lecture is somewhere connected to your day-to-day life, and it would be helping you a lot. Now again, the question arises, sir, it is a matter of open access, because until and unless it doesn't become a matter of open access, it would be restricted to some people, some organizations, some authorities.
Actually, the very important thing, again, I'm putting, there are a lot of things are going to be related with the data at the moment. Authentication as the process important, as we discuss about the health thing. The data which is requiring by the doctors can't be shared with the individuals. So those kind of things are going to be there.
I mean, this is a matter of privacy also, because otherwise anybody could intrude into the privacy of somebody, and that would be very wrong on the part of the ethical grounds. Now, taking some questions from the telecommunication department, because we have seen that as a number of the companies have come up, and a lot of the companies are providing services to the people in the area of telecommunications. In that area also, it is very beneficial.
Exactly. Now, you see, when you are making a call, take a very simple example, we are making a call to any customer service. You may understanding that you are talking to a right person, maybe not. He's a simple person who is helping you out. They have done terminal, they have some information about your services they are going to provide. So the database, they can read only. Even they cannot make the changes into that. So you can just read the databases, and the whole database is available with them. They can tell you. Take an example, if you are talking and a mobile service provided, they will tell you what are the phones call you have made, what are the services are being provided to mobile. So everything is being maintained in the databases, and that database can be accessed. In the IVR form, even you can access to the any organization where this information is available. You can ask about your details, they can provide you. not only even a person is not required, even computer will tell you about all the details, because those information is written in a database and that can be provided to you. So database is definitely playing a very important role. In other words, if I say without database nothing can be done, because each and every places you need that these information must be stored in a proper manner. Only thing is how you are going to make it more useful and user friendly so that the people can help you. Only one important thing which rightly you have pointed out, because authentication, authorization and this kind of privacy, these are the some important factor. For example, you see now you want to say the educational results and other things if related to an individual. Now the databases is going to be make in so much secure so that the only authorized person can access. Take your bank account. Now you know you can access your bank account through your mobile, through your internet facility and all. So naturally only the authorized persons can access those account, nobody else. So these are the some features where still a lot of work need to be done, but it is very useful.
So, as time is very less left with us, now the only question I would like to know, in a very small words, we can say that whether it is telecommunication, ticketing, shopping, and any other kind of thing which could be accessed, this database management have made our lives easy.
Very easy. You can see it's practically, if I said, I've given you only one example. You know, if you are going for a railway booking tickets or you are going airways and all, once you book a ticket, you usually they create a kind of database. They have a full database stored at each and every places. Number of times you can see the ticket, when you have booked the ticket, what are the price and each every detail. Next time you access, need not to enter your telephone number or the login password, you have all the details. Individual accounts are going to be there. Not only this, even you have different email accounts, that is also a kind of database, and in that email account you do have a large amount of information about yourself stored. So that is also a kind of database which is going to be stored there, and you can access this there. So these things are definitely making life very useful. One last example I'd like to give you here. For example, nowadays people are having all their documents saved in their email and all. Why? So that any time if they forget, each and every information can be accessed through the email anywhere. So which is a very easy thing. Without carrying anything, you are carrying all the information with you.
In fact, a very good example you have placed here, and I believe that if such work is also done by the government on the part of every individual, if their documents are stored in the databases of the government, it would be a very good example. But sir, we are going to conduct one more lecture on this particular topic because it is very interesting. And with this note, thank you sir, thank you so very much for being the part of the EDISET lecture.
Thank you.